There was this doctor working in an emergency room. This guy runs in, jumps on his back, and starts counting. 1, 2, 3, 4. Finally, security comes in, drags the guy off, and as he's being dragged away, he's screaming at the doctor, "You said I could count on you! You said I could count on you!" Thought I'd open with a dad joke this morning. But if you think about it, sometimes isn't that the way it is? You know, you try to do the right thing, and people are there ready to take advantage of you. It might cause some of us to then maybe be a little reluctant to put ourselves out there. But guys, that should not be the case with the followers of Christ. We are those who are the ones with the hope that should be living among the hopeless and demonstrating that hope, even though at times we may get jumped on, even though we may be misunderstood, even though it might even be worse than those things. What does it mean to be a follower of Christ in our world today? That's the question that we have been asking as we've been going through this book of 1 Peter. And if you haven't seen them, the videos are online. You can go check there. Peter has been giving these suffering Christians in these 8 different churches in Asia Minor, he's been giving them instructions on the definition and the purpose of the church. Well, today he's going to transition to a place where he's going to talk today about how we should live, that we should be good people, even in a hostile world. And over the next few weeks, we're going to see this idea applied in different scenarios, in different situations, so we'll see some different perspectives. So today, it's going to be generally the people that we are among, those as we call them here, the people in our worlds. Next week, we're going to be looking at how to apply these principles as citizens in our country, the United States. After Easter, he'll talk about it in the context of servanthood, and later, he'll talk about wives and husbands. We're going to actually do those on Mother's Day and Father's Day. And so this morning, I want to encourage you to turn to the book of 1 Peter, chapter 2. We're going to pick up in verse 11, and if you didn't get one on your way in, we have note cards available for you to take notes today. On the back are questions. If you're joining us online today, those are available on the church app. You can get the questions and the notes for today as well. Even in these familiar situations, our behavior and our conduct should be different. And why is that? Well, Peter today reminds us that as believers, this world that we live in is not our home. Verse 11 begins this way. He says, "Beloved, I urge you as foreigners and strangers." I'm going to stop right there. Some of your versions may even say aliens in place of foreigners. Now, we have a really good concept of this idea, do we not, today? I mean, we're seeing the world flooding to our borders right now. Unaccompanied minors, all kinds of examples for us of what it should mean to be a foreigner and a stranger. In the original language, a foreigner were a people who were living in a place that was not their true home. Strangers, then, it's a little bit different application. They were visitors who were staying briefly in a strange land. And what Peter is doing here is he is picturing us as foreigners in this society, in this world that we're in. Because why? Our citizenship is in heaven. Living this way should give us an entirely new perspective on how we relate to our world and how our world impacts us. A few years ago, there was a series of movies that came out known as Ice Age. Some of you have seen the Ice Age movies. And there's a particular character by the name of Scrat. And Scrat is a squirrel. Well, in one episode or one of the movies, Scrat actually somehow dies and goes to heaven. And here's what it looks like. He goes to squirrel heaven, I should say. You should know, by the way, that Scrat's major goal in life is acorns. It'll explain something here. We have streets paved with gold. He has streets paved with acorns. Being that Sprat has now seen where his true home is, and the ice age is just never going to cut it anymore for him. And that's really what Peter is getting at here. We should live as if we recognize that we are here temporarily. We're waiting for the return of Christ when he's going to take us to our real home. And as we are just passing through this world, we need to strive to remain untouched as possible by the bad behavior in the world around us. And that's the next reminder we get from Peter, and that is this, that we are on a battlefield. So we saw how he urges us as foreigners and as strangers, and he continues on in verse 11, to abstain from fleshly lusts, which wage war against our souls. Now, that phrase, fleshly lust, that just sounds bad, right? I mean, that sounds like, obviously, that's sexual, dirty, awful sin. And maybe you're at a place in your life where you're not really dealing with that. But I got to tell you, that phrase, fleshly lust, means a lot more than just sexual sins. In fact, in Galatians 5:19, we see a definition. He says, now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are... Well, no surprise, sexual immorality, impurity, indecent behavior. Well, then he kind of expands it a little. Idolatry and witchcraft. Well, I don't know about you, but I'm still okay. I haven't practiced those. But then he has to go and start meddling. Hostilities, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger. Ouch. Selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. In other words, none of us are getting away from it. We are all struggling with these things. Let's be honest, guys. One of the reasons that we're not good is because it's hard to be good. I mean, if we're honest with ourselves, and I hope you are, at least here, deep down, we're just not good people. I won't speak for you. I'll speak for myself. I'm not a good person. When I look deep inside, you know, there are some of these new age folks that say, look, go deep inside and pull out that inner person. I don't like that inner person. That inner person's got issues, okay? I just like to keep them down there, you know, away from everybody else and keep them hidden, okay? And it doesn't help that there is so much bad around us, right? It's not like I need help, but boy, have I ever got it to be bad. In fact, even in God's word, it promises us. It says, do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. Oh, boy, isn't that great news? But guys, we're stuck here, and we can't escape it, at least for now. And furthermore, we have that, again, that sinful nature inside of us, and yet... So that in some senses, we can't remain completely free from sin and its effects. But while we can't remain, we can, as Peter says here, abstain. And to abstain means to casually keep away from or to resist that desire within you. Now, you can just physically abstain. Okay, back in the 1980s, those that were around then, you of course will remember First Lady Nancy Reagan had that famous program, Just Say No. And that worked really well, right? It's not like the drug problem got any worse, right? Just say no, that did it. No, it didn't. It's escalated, if anything. Okay, so maybe just willpower isn't the thing. Although, you know, we've got some pretty good examples. There's Joseph in the Old Testament, Genesis 39, where he gets hired out to Potiphar's household. And at one point, Potiphar's wife begins taking a liking to him. And so she won't leave him alone, and she's flirting with him. And verse 12 actually goes to the full degree. She grabbed him by his garment, saying, "Sleep with me." But he left his garment in her hand, and he fled. And he went outside. I mean, literally got away from the situation. Of course, that's one way to do it. But again, guys, let's be honest. We know that there are those times when I just can't seem to say no. I can't resist that thing that I know I shouldn't do it, but I'm going to do it anyway. And I can't seem to stop myself. Well, let me tell you guys, no matter what you may think, no matter what you may feel about what you're struggling with, you can't seem to stop. It's just something you can't seem to stop. It only seems that way. In 1 Corinthians 10:13, he says, the Apostle Paul gives us this promise that no temptation has overtaken you except something common to mankind, meaning you're not the first one to deal with this. And God is faithful, so he will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will provide the very way of escape also, so that you are able to endure it. So we've got this promise from God that if you have this temptation in your life, but he is going to provide you with a way of escape. Well, what is this way of escape that he provides? Is it my feet? Is it my strong self-will? Because if it is, I'm in trouble. No, it's much more powerful than that. If you know Jesus Christ as your Savior and you desire to follow him as your Lord, one of the things that happened when you said yes to Jesus was he placed within you his Holy Spirit. Acts 1:8 puts it this way. He says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the remotest parts of the earth." So he's put this power within you so that you can resist. This is the means that God has given you to be able to resist those temptations, to follow these guidelines. It isn't just willpower, because willpower ain't going to work. Trust me, I have tried it my whole life. Willpower does not work. But God's Holy Spirit, the power he has in my life, does work. How does it work? In Ephesians 5:17, we get this great promise. Therefore, he says, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Anytime you see a phrase like that, understand what the will of the Lord is, pay attention. You're about to get God's will. And here it is. Do not get drunk with wine, in which there is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit. So it's God's will to not drink wine? No, he's making an analogy here. He is saying that just as the drunk is controlled by the wine, and they are, I know from personal experience in my home growing up, that drunks are controlled by wine. They become very different people. I watched it happen. And he says, in that same way, the Holy Spirit wants to empower you, wants you to be controlled and empowered by his Spirit. And how do you do that? You say, Lord Jesus, control me. Lord Jesus, fill me with your Spirit. In fact, that's what that word fill means. It actually means to be controlled, to be empowered. Lord, fill me with your Spirit. Let me ask you a question, and I expect an answer here. What's more powerful, my word or God's word?
God's word.
All right, good. Good for you. Y'all get an A today. Yes. Now, I say, I don't think I can withstand this. God's word says you are able to withstand every temptation. God's word says he has given you the power to do so. Therefore, is that true or not? It's true. Yes, it's yours for the asking. Now, some people say, well, why doesn't he just put it in me and leave it there? Because God wants us willingly following him. He doesn't want to turn us into robots or automatons, okay? He gives us that free will. I have a choice whether I'm going to follow him. And when I'm faced with a temptation, with something that I know I shouldn't do, that God's word tells me, I have a choice. Am I just going to barrel through and give into it? Or am I going to draw upon the power and the strength of the Lord, of the Holy Spirit within me? That's my choice. So when you're following, call out to him, Lord Jesus, fill me with your spirit. I can't resist this. Control me and empower me. But again, we're being very honest here today, right? Let's be really honest. Sometimes I don't want God to stop me. I want this, right? And so we ask the question today, why should I be good? Why should I abstain from fleshly lust? I mean, after all, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. I know you guys have made those arguments. Our youth group has asked those questions. Good for them. That's a good question. Paul says that's a crazy way to live your life. In Romans 6:1, he even says, should sin increase so that grace may abound? In other words, he was making the argument that no matter how much you sin, God's grace is going to be sufficient to cover it. And so if your sin increases, so will grace. And so he then answers people who say, well, then the more I sin, the more grace I get. And Paul's answer to that is, may it never be. And I love the way one of my professors said, a loose translation of that phrase, may it never be, is this. No, 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 don't be stupid. I kind of like his way of putting it. That's not the way to live our lives. Because, why should we abstain from fleshly lust? What does he say here? What does Peter abstain? He says, because these lusts wage war against our souls. And that's serious, guys. It's doing damage to you. Yeah, you'll go to heaven, but you're going to be pretty beat up by the time you get there if this is the way you're going to live your life. We are on a battlefield. That word war is a picture of a military campaign. And a military campaign is not just a one and done kind of a thing. It's not just one battle. It's an ongoing thing. And so these lusts that he's talking about here, it's like rebels. It's like they're using guerrilla tactics against us. It's why the Vietnam War could go on for nearly 20 years. You've got this little tiny country that's taking on the world's superpowers, and yet they prevailed over us. Why? Because of their tactics, because they never gave up. And that's the war that he's talking about, that he's picturing here. When you became a believer in Jesus Christ, the war began. Prior to knowing Christ, I know people have told me, man, I didn't have problems until I became a Christian. Well, of course you didn't, because you were part of the enemy prior to knowing Christ. He's going to leave you alone. He doesn't want to bother you. If you're going to be separated from God, I'll just leave you there. You just enjoy your life. But once you said yes to Jesus Christ, now you've joined the enemy as far as our enemy is concerned. And you now have an aggressive army against you. But guess what? You have someone greater than the one in the world on your side as well. Now, it would seem like lusts, and which are desires, right? It's thoughts and all of that. It would seem that those are less serious than actions. I mean, if I'm gonna play the odds, it's better that I think about doing sin than actually committing sins, right? Wrong. Yeah, you saw that one coming, didn't you? Yeah. I said, right. I hear about five of you go, wrong. Okay. No, because there is these lusts, again, they're waging war against your soul. What did Jesus say in Matthew 5:27? He said, you have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But then he ups the ante, doesn't he? But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lust for her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. The war is against your soul. And frankly, if that's the situation you're in, it's only a matter of time before you're going to commit adultery. Again, I know, not adultery, but I know sin from experience. The more I think about it and don't turn my mind away from it, the more obvious it's going to be that eventually I'm going to give in to that. The problem with lust, you see, is not that it hurts God or hurts other people. The problem is that it wars against us. It tears us up. It wears us down. Guys, Satan wants to destroy you. But he doesn't want to do it necessarily overtly. He doesn't come with a pitchfork and a big red man and you know, because most of us would know to run away from that. No, he comes subtly. He comes in our minds. He comes in our thoughts. He gets you to compromise just a little bit. That's no big deal. Just compromise here and there until there's nothing left. It's why you can live your life and one day, it's almost like one day you wake up and you think, how did I get here? Look at what I'm doing. I can't imagine that I would have ever gotten to this place in my life. It's because you didn't get there all at once. You got there little by little by little. It's like the idea of the frog in the kettle, if you know that story. You boil frogs by not putting them in a pot of hot water. You put them in a pot of cold water and turn the heat up, and little by little, you get the frog boiled. I don't know why you want to boil frogs, but if you do, now you know how. But guys, don't let that get to you. Remember, again, what he's been telling us. This world is not our home. We are foreigners. We are strangers in this world. We're on this battlefield, and through the Spirit's power, we can abstain from fleshly lusts. God does not command us to do something where he does not also give us the ability to carry out his command. He doesn't set us up for failure. Now, these negative commands, it's been pretty negative so far. Don't do this, don't do that. It's now followed by a positive instruction here in verse 12. Look what he says. Keep your behavior excellent among the Gentiles, so that in the thing in which they slander you as evildoers, they may, because of your good deeds as they observe them, glorify God on the day of visitation. And that's our final point here this morning. What's he telling us? He's telling us that somebody is watching you. I always think of the psychiatrist who sat down with his longtime patient. And he said, I've got good news and I've got bad news. And the guy said, okay, go ahead, give me the good news. Well, the good news is that you're not paranoid. What's the bad news? Well, everybody is watching you. And that's the way we are. That's that people are watching us. We aren't good for our own, just for our own spiritual well-being. We are good also so that those people in our worlds are effectively ministered to. We have these cards, and I hope you have one. If you don't, grab one on the way out this morning. And we use these as we put feet to our belief that our mission primarily is to the people in our worlds. And so we pray and we ask God, who are these people? Usually there's about 8 or 15 of them. And who are these people? And then we list them. We write down their names and we start to pray for them. And we start to have an impact. We pray to have an impact in their life and the ability to overtly invite them to an experience or even, you know, praise the Lord, invite them to Jesus Christ himself. And as we do this, the first impact I guarantee you that you're going to have with anybody is what are you doing? What kind of person are you? He talks here about the Gentiles. Now, the Gentiles, this word that he's using here, he's not talking about just a particular race of people. This is another way for him to say all people. You could substitute your world for that word Gentiles there. It's kind of like when I call you guys. You know, I've had people say, don't you talk to the women too? And, you know, well, guys, that's the way I am. You know, that's the way I say it. So I've tried to root that out of my language. It just ain't going. So it's a term of endearment for all of you. But that's how he's using Gentiles here today. And you can be sure, guys, that now you're really going to hear it now. You're going to be sure that they are watching you. Not only that, they are speaking against us. Amen? I mean, you've heard the criticism. They're looking, in one sense, for an excuse to reject what you have to say. Because, you see, if I don't like the fact that you're telling me that without Jesus, I'm going to hell, I can either accept that or I can come up with some reason why that doesn't make sense. And quite often the reason is the way you live your life. When Peter wrote this, Christians were being slandered, as he says here, as evildoers. They were known as rebels because they talked about another kingdom. They were known as terrorists because they were blamed for the burning of Rome. They were considered atheists, believe it or not, because they wouldn't bow down to idols. They wouldn't worship the emperor like the rest of society. They were thought of as cannibals because of the Lord's Supper. Did you hear what those Christians said? They're eating his body. They're drinking his blood over there. That's what they are. He said they were immoral because Jesus, their founder, talked about loving one another. They damaged the trade and the social order. Society was based upon things that they were against. And so there were all kinds of openings for them to ignorantly, if you will, slander the Christians. And guys, it's no different today. I mean, just listen to the media, listen to the people sometimes in your world. You'll hear people say things like Christianity and religion in general is the single biggest cause of most of the death and suffering in the world today. By the way, if somebody says that to you, ask them to show you the statistics for that because they're not there. It ain't true. Atheism has done far more damage than even religion and certainly Christianity. That you'll hear people say that Christians are violent and corrupt and superstitious, that they think they're better than everybody else. And of course, the words we hear today is that we're bigots and we're sexists and we're homophobic. And frankly, since January 6th, now we're downright dangerous because they saw a Christian flag in the crowd. They saw people with signs that said Jesus on them. Oh yes, you know those Christians. We're being slandered. Why is that? It's a major reason for us to be good because critics generally have some actual experience with Christians behaving badly that has caused them then to slander all Christians. I read this week an account from John MacArthur, the pastor at Grace Community Church, and it's a good illustration of this point. He says, one day a lawyer in our church by the name of Sam, who was working for a large law firm in Los Angeles, was having lunch with a group of attorneys in the city of Los Angeles. He was very active as an elder in our church, as it was his custom and habit to invite men to come to church to hear the word of God. And so he said to one attorney that he had met, I'd like you to come to my church with me. I'd like you to be my guest. And the man said, well, what church do you go to? He says, I go to Grace Community Church out in the San Fernando Valley. Well, the man hesitated for a moment and looked a bit shocked. And then he said, I would never go to that church under any circumstances. And Sam said to him, well, what makes you say that? Have you been there? He says, I have never been there and I will never go there. And Sam said, well, how can you make that kind of judgment about a church that you've never attended? He said, it's simple. The most crooked attorney I know in this city attends that church. MacArthur goes on. He says, I remember how distressed I was when Sam told me that. So the following Sunday, I got in the pulpit. If you know anything about MacArthur, you know something's coming. I told them the story and I said, I don't know which one of you attorneys is that one, but I wish you'd get your act together or else quit saying you belong to this church because the character of your life is making evangelism impossible. Guys, the single greatest tool that we have in evangelism is doing good. Christians' lives should back up the words that they are saying. The bottom line is to evangelism is not what we say, it's what we do, or even more, it's who we are. It's like that old saying, I have it on my wall. The staff gave it to Paul and I a couple of years ago. And it says, who you are speaks so loud that the world can't hear what you're saying. Lest we think that just the right words, you know, seals the deal. No, my life has to be correct as well. In summary, guys, you should be good because you're being watched. Here's how one commentator summarized this whole section. Do you see how imperative it is that we live godly lives? We want unbelievers to examine us. Now, at first, they may come to criticize us, but if our behavior is excellent, that criticism of some of them might actually turn to curiosity. And if that curiosity turns them to Christ, then they will glorify God because of their salvation. And this is only part of bringing God glory. You lead people to the reality of Christianity and ultimately to Christ himself by the quality of your life. So stay away from fleshly lusts and maintain excellent behavior in the power of the Holy Spirit within you. Here's how the Apostle Paul said it to the Corinthians in Colossians 4. He says, conduct yourselves with wisdom toward outsiders, making the most of the opportunity. Your speech must always be with grace, as though seasoned with salt, so that you will know how you should respond to each person. Here's my takeaways from this passage this morning. The first one is this: where is my home? I've traveled to a lot of places, some of them not really great. And I've been on mission trips to third world countries. And one of the things being in those places is I can always think to myself, I've got home to go to. And that's really how I should be living this life. It's easy to get down on the experiences we have, the way people behave, the government. You know, we can come up with all kinds of things to criticize. That's not hard. But maybe we ought to look at this as I would look at a third world country. I don't go there and complain about, what happened to your floors? This is just dirt. What kind of food is this? I don't do that. I recognize that I am a visitor. I am a foreigner. I am a stranger in this place. And I put up with it for that time because I know afterwards I'm going home. And I'm going to get the food I like. And there's carpet on the floor. Second takeaway I have is, am I generally winning or losing the war? I would encourage you to memorize and apply Ephesians 5:18, that we need to be controlled and empowered by the Holy Spirit. I was going to quote it, and for some reason it's out of my head. I do have it memorized. I'm not advising you to do something I can't do, but memorize it and let's start winning. And finally, what do my actions say to those in my world? It's interesting that Ty and Monique are here today, because I put this together before they came today, but you'll see why in a minute, how it's interesting that they're here. Nowhere, I would say, have our negative actions done more harm than in our relationship with other races, with other peoples, with other religions. In 1805, the Boston Missionary Society requested permission to evangelize among the Iroquois settlements in northern New York State. And the chief of the group, Sagiawatha, made a defense of their native religion. And here was his conclusion. It's a pretty interesting document to read, and he's a very well thought out individual. Here's what he said: brother, you say that there is but one way to worship and serve the Great Spirit. If there is but one religion, why do you white people differ so much about it? Why not all agree, as you can all read the book? Again, it's another great question we've got from our teenagers. I love it. You know, why are they so different? Why do we argue over things when we've all got the same book? That would be a whole nother sermon for weeks, frankly. There is an answer to it. But catch what he says next. This is how he concludes. Brother, I love the way he says brother. Brother, we are told that you have been preaching to the white people in this place. These people are our neighbors. We are acquainted with them. We will wait a little while and see what effect your preaching has upon them. If we find it does them good, makes them honest and less disposed to cheat Indians, we will then consider again what you have said. Now, I'd love to say this had a positive result, but it didn't. What was the sad response to this, I think, very reasonable and biblical request, as we've seen this morning? The representative of the Boston Missionary Society refused to even shake the chief's hand, and he announced that no fellowship could ever exist between the religion of God and the works of the devil. Is that not sad? And that's just one example. We could probably go on for days talking about the bad examples that even Christians have had in our world today. We can do much better than that. Amen? Amen. Through the power of his Spirit within us, you're never going to say anything like that if God's Spirit is controlling you and empowering you, right? I mean, if the Holy Spirit is controlling you, you're not going to refuse to shake some guy's hands. I don't care who you are. I don't care what you've done. I'm going to shake your hand, even if you have COVID, right? I'm going to be there for you. Guys, you can jump on my back and count on me. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. Thank you for the power that you offer to us to not just hear this word and be convicted by it, but Father, to actually carry it out. May we be your people that do that today as we go from here to our worlds who are watching us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.